knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
The next reaction we will discuss was invented in 1973 by German chemist Hermann Stetter, who worked and taught at the University of Aachen. This very interesting reaction is another example of Umpolung, or polarity inversion, a concept we introduced in a previous tutorial. Although it exemplifies a concept we already introduced, the Stetter reaction allows us to examine another concept, that of catalytic reactions. Let us first introduce the reaction. The catalyst which drives the Stetter reaction is a thiazolium salt, and this allows the condensation of an aldehyde with an enone. Note that this transformation is similar to the Umpolung with nitronate anions in conjunction with the Neff reaction, which we have discussed, but it has the advantage that we do not have to use an aldehyde equivalent. Rather, the aldehyde itself is used directly, and it appears to produce an acyl anion, which is added to the conjugate position of an enone. Since we know acyl anions are not stable species, one may ask how this has happened. One fact that may be surprising is that thiazolium salts are good carbon acids, and even a base like triethylamine can form the anion. One reason the anion forms easily is that it is stabilized by resonance through a carbene, and indeed these species, which are quite good nucleophiles, are often categorized as stable carbenes. Now, this stable carbene is not just a carbene, but it bears some charge at the C2 carbon, and is therefore a weak nucleophile, capable of reacting with a good electrophile like an aldehyde, as follows. So we have an attack from the Zwitter ion onto the carbonyl, with formation of an adduct, a more complex thiazolium salt, featuring a very basic alkoxide function, which picks up a proton from the protonated base, which had formed the Zwitter ion in the first place. Now it gets complicated. It turns out that the thiazolium salt, with its positive charge, can not only stabilize a negative charge at the alpha position, but also the beta position. This Zwitter ion is stabilized via resonance, not through a carbene, but rather a stable neutral species, with every carbon reaching its octet. We could call this an enol. It is a special enol because it is nucleophilic at the OH-bearing carbon due to its Zwitter ionic form, and not, as we would typically expect with an enol, at the position beta to the hydroxyl, if one were to push the lone pair down onto the double bond. Now we see why we use the term Umpolung here. The carbon which was in the carbonyl of the aldehyde has suddenly become nucleophilic instead of electrophilic, and we are ready to attack the enone. The new Zwitter ion attacks the enone at the conjugate position, yielding an enolate, which gets protonated by the alcohol, yielding an alkoxide, which fragments to the product and back to the catalyst, which is the thiazolium Zwitter ion. The catalyst is regenerated, ready to perform the same reaction again. If you have followed along so far, you may have a few questions. For example, why is the reaction of the aldehyde with the thiazolium going forwards, and why is the last step essentially the same chemistry going backwards? Well, these are all equilibrium reactions, and while the attack of the thiazolium Zwitter ion onto the aldehyde is favored thermodynamically, the one on a ketone is not, and that is why the last step, which regenerates the Zwitter ion, is favored. The catalyst goes from being bound to a ketone to binding an aldehyde, an energetically favorable step. You may also ask why the initial adduct between thiazolium and aldehyde attacks the enone and not another molecule of aldehyde. Well, it does, but these are all equilibria. The self-condensation of two aldehyde molecules is reversible, and the equilibria favor attack onto the enone. And so, this is a very nice way to form 1,4-dicarbonyls. No synthetic equivalents are needed, and the aldehyde is turned into a nucleophile by the action of small amounts of a catalyst. Pretty clever stuff. You may wonder how Stetter came up with such a brilliant idea, and indeed, why that particular structure of thiazolium catalyst. It turns out that this brilliant trick was invented by nature. Somehow, nature must have made these thiazolium salts and found them indispensable in order to create carbon chains or cleave them. The design that nature came up with is called thiamine, or the backbone of vitamin B1. As you can see from its structure, thiamine was copied by Stetter by replacing the complex pyrimidine side chain with a phenyl group. Thiamine and its phosphate derivatives catalyze a host of fantastic biochemical pathways. For example, the catalytic reaction which degrades oxoglutarate to succinyl coenzyme A uses this Umpolung trick through the action of a Stetter-like reaction. Here's how it works. The thiazolium zwitterion attacks the very reactive ketone, which forms another zwitterion, rapidly losing CO2 and forming an Umpolung adduct. The acyl carbon, as we have seen, is now nucleophilic and attacks the sulfur atom of a disulfide, coenzyme lipoic acid. Then the thiamine is regenerated, and the thiol of coenzyme A exchanges with the thiol of lipoic acid, yielding succinyl coenzyme A, a form of succinic acid ready for more catabolism. This is how nature solved the problem of removing a carbon from oxoglutarate, and thiamine is very useful in solving a host of natural Umpolung problems. In addition to learning how nature can inspire synthetic operations we never thought possible, we have also encountered our first catalytic reaction in this series on name reactions. This allows us to introduce a special kind of symbolism to represent mechanisms, the catalytic cycle. Here we represent all the catalytic intermediates within a cycle and the stoichiometric inputs on the outside. As the cycle proceeds, aldehyde and enone are consumed, forming the 1,4-diketone. The first two steps are reversible, but the third one is not, and this makes the cycle go downhill in free energy. The intermediates in the cycle are present in very low concentrations, their sum being equal to the amount of catalyst we have introduced, usually 5 to 10 mole%. There has been extensive development of this fantastic concept over the last 50 years. For example, a variety of azolium systems have been used, acceptors other than enones have been used, and even the use of aldehydes has been extended to 1,2-dicarbonyls, acyl silanes, and other systems. We would need hours to review all the clever variations organic chemists have concocted on this theme. We will illustrate these developments with one of the enantioselective applications of the reaction through the work of Frank Glorious, professor of organic chemistry at the University of Munster. Here, the catalyst was changed to a triazolium salt, and a chiral appendage was fused to the ring to induce enantioselectivity. The acceptor is an alpha-dehydroamino acid, and the new functionalized amino acid is formed in 94% enantiomeric excess, which means 97% purity for the S form. This is therefore also a good method to prepare unnatural amino acids, meaning non-canonical amino acids which do not exist in nature. This is a current hot topic in organic chemistry and biology. Scientists have been able to insert unnatural amino acids into bacterial proteins and have actually designed new bacteria that can feed and replicate while making unnatural proteins, essentially semi-synthetic bacteria with new designed functions. Let's conclude by saying that the Stetter reaction is a great way to reverse polarity in organic chemistry, and it continues to receive hundreds of applications since it was invented, especially since it uses only a catalytic amount of the chiral inducer. This is a very current name reaction that any organic chemist must know.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.